Meeting to order. I do have one adjustment to the agenda, and that is we will have an executive session after, you know, at the end, and it will be related to personnel matters. Jeff is not a member of the audience, so I assume there's no one here for audience and communications. So we will move right into our presentation on proficiency-based learning.
Outstanding. So I actually put a packet of information out to each one of you, so if you want.
Let's see, I'll grab you one right across the way there.
I'll steal Kathy's, so thank you, Alan, very much.
Yeah, if you want to sit there, because we'll be behind you.
All right, that'll be easy.
But hopefully the first page is pretty familiar. You know, our hope was that the CSSU would kind of warm you up. Stan and Emily would kind of get you some introduction to transferable standards and those pieces. But Jeff and I are going to team up here, and it might seem odd to have Jeff do it, but reason for that is we honestly believe that one of the basis of proficiency-based learning at Shelburne Community School is we couldn't do this effectively without technology and technology integration. It really is a key piece. So Jeff and I have kind of partnered up. Jeff is our tech integrationist, technology coach at Shelburne. And so he and I are going to pair up. So you can bounce through. So this quote of, or just this slide just summarizes just kind of our approach to it. You know, you may hear around the country that, you know, we're talking about extending school days and school years and that kind of thing. I think CSSU correctly has taken a pretty different approach to that, and that is that we've got enough time, but we really have to change how we're using that time. And so to me, that's what standards-based learning is all about, is kind of approaching that. A lot of learning we're going to do, the first two pages that I put in here, I won't really reference them, I just wanted you to have them, is you'll find this page here, the transferable standards, in just about every classroom in our school, especially at 6-8, where it really is having meaning. And if you have problems with the visual, you can flip it over on the back, and we kind of have those transferable standards on the back in a much more readable format. Those of you who sat through my curriculum nights have seen that part already. The piece you might not have seen, and won't talk about much, is this page here, which is the connections, and kind of has this colored on the back. This is the handout to teachers on the first day of school on August 26th that talked about, here's the learning that we have to do as a system over the next year. A lot of what standards-based learning is being real clear about the learning targets and what we try to accomplish, and then clarifying for students kind of what's the progression, where might you be at as you're emerging in your learning, and what would be really proficient. And so if you look at this color side on the back sometime and you want to know what are we doing on Tuesday afternoons, which I can't thank you enough for, this is the work we're really trying to accomplish. This is the work of standards-based learning, helping us learn to kind of establish what we're trying to accomplish. That's our learning targets. Figure out how's a student going to be able to show it, how are we going to teach them to do that, and how are we going to assess and then go back and have them practice. That is the basics that I imagine you just heard about quite a bit from Stan and Emily. So I won't reference this, but wanted you to have it. Okay?
So just a question.
Yep.
Now that we're going into the conference period,
yep.
I mean, as a parent, should we expect that the teachers will be speaking to these transferable skills and how those fit in their different classes, whether it's LA or?
Mm-hmm. Not only would I hope that the teachers will be speaking to it, but I hope that Neva can speak to it. I hope that she'd be able to sit down at that conference and explain, okay, this work I'm doing in math is related to this transferable standard. You know, And that's really been a lot of our work, is with students trying to help them understand what's the importance of this and how does this connect to the learning we're doing.
So you think the students are clear on the end game that these?
Absolutely, okay. Not yet.
But that's where they're going.
Absolutely not. I don't want to portray that we're more than 8 weeks down the road on this journey. But, you know, the word that keeps coming out is this meta-clueless word that we're using, which is, we're thinking really hard about this, we know where we're going, and we're having to cycle back ourselves, because this is honestly having, I've been an educator for 32 years. This is undoing some ways I've done things for a long time, in a good way, in a very real way. But you know, that means that we are going to stall. It's going to be good learning. We're going to try some things and go, well, that didn't go so well. So what are we going to do now? Okay.
Okay, thank you.
Yep. So
before you get started,
yeah.
One of the things I kept using, and sorry, I don't know the definition of this. Could you give me an example of the difference between a formative assessment and a summative assessment?
Sure.
I think I know that a summative assessment is the end.
Yep.
And the final project, the final product, showing how you've used all these different steps. But what is a formative assessment?
So a formative assessment, in its simplest sense, let's talk in math per se. You know, in math, and if we're in that case, I'm going to talk about a specific content standard. You know, so we have a student who wants to be able to, let's say, graph a linear equation. Well, I might give a formative that is very specific and very structured and kind of lays out the pieces and says, if I give you these points, can you graph a line? And you demonstrate you can do it.
Okay.
A summative is going to be, okay, can you apply it? Can you do something with it? Given this situation of traveling from A to B, or let's say maybe calculating the height of a tree using the slope and Pythagorean theorem, can use that same, but it's really an abstract application in a way that probably I haven't even coached you on how to do it yet. So the summative is really, what can I do with the knowledge? Where the formative can be very specific. It's the practice we do along the way.
Formative assessments, if you want to relate it to sports.
Formative assessments in basketball would be all your practices, your scrimmages. Summative assessments, the game.
Yep.
And one of the things we've learned is we used to grade everything and combine it all. And now formatives should be very low risk opportunities so that you can get out there and fail and learn from that. Mm-hmm. So formatives are really practice.
Yep.
And summatives are when you demonstrate that learning based on all the practice you've done.
So my goal in the next 5 minutes, if I was to lay out my learning target for you for those next 5 minutes, is that I hope if a parent comes up to you on the street, you know, we want you to be some of the most informed supporters of Shelburne Community School there are. If they come up to you on the street and go, what, why the heck are you, why are they doing this PBL? Why are they doing this transferable standards? I'm going to give you what's my best pitch for it, kind of the elevator speech. Okay, not because I think you need it, but I kind of want to empower you with it. And also to have you tear it apart for me. Okay, and go, well, have you thought of it this way? Because this is moving us in a very different direction. We feel completely aligned with CSSU and CVU. But I don't think that's a reason to stand on. I mean, there's two reasons we could stand on is, one is the law in Vermont, it's Act 77, we have to be proficiency-based by 2020. The other is, oh, CVU chose to do this and our kids are going to CVU. But to me, that's kind of lame. It's like, well, so what? Wouldn't you argue with CVU if they were making a mistake? We believe it's the right direction, so let me try. And I ground myself in this piece of knowledge, which really is here, and that is that, you know, it's pretty much, this is the World Economic Forum, you can find this all over the place, but we're coming to recognize that the majority of our kids are going to enter careers, and we don't even know what those careers are today. The jobs don't even exist. That's just the reality of, you know, who thought that, you know, that Airbnb would take over the hotel business? And yet it is. It's the largest thing. You know, these whole network jobs. The other piece is that our young people are going to change their careers 6 or 7 times during their lifetime. Not change jobs. I understand changing jobs. I went from Alaska to here. But the thought of changing a career, to me, honestly, that's overwhelming. I know education. I know how to be administrator. I know how to teach. Would I think of becoming a management in the paper business or moving over to become an engineer at Burton? Not a chance, but our kids are going to be asked to do those kind of dramatic changes. And I think that dramatically changes what we need to do. And so, Jeff, you go ahead. And some people are saying that we're throwing away content. I don't think we are at all. In fact, I think we're overwhelmed and we're drowning in content. I mean, just within the Common Core State Standards, in math alone, each grade level has like 95 standards. You can't possibly teach all this material. And then we throw in language arts, and then we throw in next-gen science and social studies and PE and all these. We've done really good work, okay? We've done really good work for the last, I would say, 15 years defining these standards. We've got to compact them. We've got to determine what's important. And here's the analogy I use. Go ahead, Jeff. I use sports. For me, if you think of these gold medal winners, these are all the gold medal winners from the Olympics down in Brazil. What do they all have in common? Can you name some things? There's five.
They all had a goal that they were working for.
So they knew how to set goals.
Everything to get that goal.
Exactly. They were probably very driven, right? What else?
Lots of practice.
Lots of practice. Yeah. They knew how to stick with it, right? They had perseverance. Think they knew how to solve problems? Okay. Think they knew how to think through their challenges that were ahead of them? Okay. There's a whole set of transferable skills. Now, within each of these disciplines, if we take Michael Phelps and pop him on a road bike, he's not a champion anymore. He had a specific set of skills. I think the challenge facing us is, what's for every young person that's sitting in our grade level classrooms right now, what's the specific set of content knowledge they're going to need? We don't know it anymore. Are we going to turn them into an engineer? I know what an engineer needs. Or do really we have to teach them how to learn and how to think and how to persevere? That's what those transferable standards, if we go to the next slide, that's why I think we've come to say these, and we'll be bold about it, these are more important than content. That in the lives of our kids, yes, there are some things that we all have to be able to read, but really that's we all have to be able to communicate. We all have to be able to be citizens in our country, in our communities, and be responsible, involved, and responsible for each other. We better know how to think. We better know how to solve problems. We better be able to do it on our own, because nobody's going to be there to pull us along. So that's where we've kind of got ourselves grounded in these transferable skills and are saying, this is what's most important. But now the challenge is, it's easy to measure whether somebody can get the right answer in a math problem. 2 + 2 = 4. How do I know if somebody has self-direction? How are you going to show it to me? How are we going to assess that? What is going to be? And that's really what proficiency-based learning is about, is we're learning how to create and help students understand what's the evidence that they can think, what's the evidence they can problem solve, and how are we going to show them so they know the pathway. And they say, yeah, this is where I want to be. So if you go to the next one, here's sort of an example of how broad we're trying to be. You might be used to in science, I know when I used to early on with standards, I would write science targets that would be, yes, a student is able to understand the structures of a cell. Okay. We're trying to be broad and say, no, really it's about modeling. That really, and we're trying to get these transferable standards that, okay, maybe I learn how to model through science, but can I model an economic system? Certainly, could this apply to social studies? Could this apply to math? Could this apply to anything? We're starting to write our standards that way and define the set of outcomes that we want to reach, and content is just embedded in it. So a student could show me this. If I'm really going to personalize, a student could show me their ability to create a clear model just through what they're interested in. That personalization we're a ways from. We don't quite know how to do that yet, but that's where we're headed, and that's really where I think technology is going to help us. Okay. The last piece, just I love this model because I think it defines what learning is. Learning is about, we need students who can have an input, they can grab some information, they can get it through reading, listening, watching, experiencing, they need to be able to think about it, and they need to be able to do something with it. Yeah. Well, for a long time, we've lived right here and said, well, we just assume they can think. We're actually living here more than anything. They still need to have good content, but we've got to go through them and create something with it. I don't care what you know. I care what you can do with it. because most of the content that's out there, you and I know, Siri can get it faster than my brain can anyways. But that's useless if I can't think and do something with it. And so this is where we've come to say, we don't think we can do this in the 21st century without technology. Just about every way we access, I don't know the last time you opened up a World Book Encyclopedia. I mean, if I need a fact, I'm going to find it with technology. Even in terms of production, when's the last time you wrote something? Hand wrote it. I don't know, do you write, hand write a lot, Bob? Okay. I have to admit I don't anymore. I use technology, and then I have to produce things. Even this presentation here has been presented for you using technology, and hopefully it's better than it was if I didn't have technology.
In support of my good friend Bob in the paper industry, I do still.
You do still take notes? Okay.
You got me handwritten.
Yeah, old school. Yeah. Share with the times, boys, really.
And then I transfer them to other electronic.
Right. There you go.
All right, so let me check my learning target. If you're cornered tomorrow and somebody says, what's all this transferable standards crap about? Could you answer it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Did I help that at all?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. That was the first part. The next piece I wanted to introduce Jeff and say, Jeff, take it away and show all the cool stuff that you're doing around technology related to performance-based learning. So,
okay.
Jeff's the man. I'll drive.
Mm-hmm. All right. So this is my second year at Shelburne, by the way. I'm enjoying it very much. What I want to put up here is the what we call the SAMR model. I want to give you an idea of what we're doing with technology. So I think sometimes, because technology is so ubiquitous and we have it everywhere, we sometimes don't think that in a setting like education, it's being ruled out in a very thoughtful way. Okay, so it's not just put out there. And so SAMR stands for, it's an acronym for substitution, augmentation, modification, and redefinition. And that, those are the ways in which technology a teacher and or a student would use them would use it. So you can think of like writing a persuasive essay, right? And right, a lot of people, I guess, right, can handwrite it. To substitute would just be to get on a device and type it. That's it. You're just using technology as a substitute. And it, you know, it, there's advantages there. But going beyond that, to augment, you might. So we use Google Docs in the classroom, and so students who write their persuasive essay, now they're getting real-time feedback with comments from the teacher and the other students. So that's augmenting. It's now technology is being used to give a little improvement there. To modify, students are taking, right, to go up here to where they're now transforming what it is, they're taking that same persuasive essay and they're putting it in a blog and putting links inside to take you into other parts to show their point. They're embedding images to make their point as well. And then the same persuasive essay, students are taking it and creating videos with it. So now they're putting speech and verbal as well as written language together and sharing that with a real audience and getting that feedback. So that's how the technology is being used in school. I can go to the next one. And this one here I like because this is sort of what I do with teachers. The teacher has their content knowledge, right? Social studies, English, and they pair it with pedagogical knowledge, right? The knowledge of teaching and how to teach kids, and they're putting those together all the time, right? And that has always defined teaching, right? Now we're putting this other sort of realm on it, this other technological knowledge, right? And this is educational technology, how it is these tools, we're putting that into the fray so that they can redefine, right? You can think of the power that you have now when you modify and redefine teaching, right? The process, communication in the classroom, setting up different workflows. It used to be you just turned in your assignment in the basket, and the teacher corrected them and put them back in the basket for you or handed them out. Now, students are turning stuff in digitally, getting real-time feedback, sharing that with some students, getting feedback, and that the classroom looks very different. It feels different, right? And so teachers, right, so I work with teachers and coach them around sort of what are some strategies to get that done, right, and teach them certain platforms in which they might do it. The power is still here, right? This is just redefining what we do, adding that other piece on. You can go to the next slide. Yeah. All right. And so these are the pillars of personalized learning. And they're really the three, you might consider them the three pillars of Act 77, right? And flexible pathways. And what I really like, educators are talking about this in all these different ways. But what I like to see it as proficiency-based learning here. When you were looking for proficiencies under a transferable skill, right, you're opening up other pathways for learning, both outside of the classroom, right? Because if you're talking about clear and effective communication, you can meet that anywhere, right? It doesn't even have to be in the classroom, right? And so to have students come in and maybe they presented to people, or maybe they came to a small group and presented, they might reflect on that moment or come in with a video about that moment. And now we as teachers are able to take that further or assess it, right? So there are other pathways. It opens up pathways for students, again, anytime, anywhere. And that's, right, that obviously looks different when they start going to high school, right? When we talk about tech school, starting to explore college courses even before they get to college, right? So that could be big. Or just aligning ourselves with community partners, as we do with the Shelburne Craft School, and open up pathways to, again, keep going after those transferable skills. And the other thing it does is it brings the student on board to be a negotiator for their education, right? So they're the stakeholder who has the most to gain or lose by what's happening in the classroom every day. They have to have a voice in it and to be able to personalize that situation, their education. So we're trying to come up with ways in which we get the students on board, and we know too by best practice that's where the motivation is, to connect learning to their passions instead of putting ours out there. So that's what I see for transferable skills there as we're using technology. So right now we have to find a way to document what students are doing, as we always have, but when it's personalized learning, the student has a say in that, right? So we have to find a way. And these are three platforms that we've piloted, or we are piloting, and we're still exploring them. The first is Naviance. And what we liked about this one is there's a lot of great student inventories in there for students to find out what kind of a learner they are, what kind of a person they are, what motivates them, right? And the guidance counselors helped us sort of deliver those. And we still like that. It just turned out to be a pretty clunky classroom tool. And for that reason, it's not working, or wasn't working so well. So then we went to Google Sites, and I can give you an example of what that looked like. Yeah, right there. And it basically had these tabs where students were taking the work that they'd done and embedding it into these different sites. So each student had their own website, really. They would share it with friends and they'd share it with teachers, and it could be a centerpiece for a student-led conference with their parents. The thing about this is it was really teacher-directed. We're like, yeah, put it in that tab. Put it in this tab. And it was really something that, why don't you put that in your portfolio? And it wasn't something that they had a choice about. We did a lot of work around the goals, as we still do, right? To make it specific to the task at hand, measurable, attainable. So it's not just students, right? You can imagine what students would come up with, but guiding them around making a good goal that's going to show their learning. Now we're currently using Protean. We're piloting it, taking a look at it. And this is a little bit more flexible platform. It's just it's very open. Students just post, just like in social networking. They just post a reflection, some evidence of their learning, right? And they can use that then to talk with their peers and teachers. So this is one of the platforms students are using, and we're excited to get student feedback about it. Is it working for them?
Jeff, does that mean that e-portfolios are kind of passe at this point?
Not passe. It's just taking on a different form.
So you're using this tool instead of the Google.
That's right. Yep. That's right.
I think if I could help clarify what we've done is
we recognize students need a place to show their work and their evidence proficiencies. That's either happening in an e-portfolio, or in some cases we've gone back to, you know, a binder that is a portfolio. Students enjoyed that kind of that body of work. Whereas the PLP, which is a student's way to say, here's my goal, here's the learning that I'm really passionate about, that's what we want them to work through Protean. They get control of Protean. These are going to look totally different, and it's a way that they can have their learning, share it with each other. We are going to push them to link the transferable skills to it, so they can say, oh, as I'm learning this, I'm doing this thing on my own time, I'm creating this project, I'm creating this, I'm doing this completely out of school. How does that relate to the learning you're doing in school? Hopefully they're starting to see those connections.
So is Protean something that a parent now can go in and see where they're learning?
Just rolled out. We have one team that has rolled out, and I think several teams are going to roll them out at parent-teacher conferences. Absolutely brand new novel work we were just introduced to this summer at the Middle Grades Institute through Terran. So we're excited about it, but not totally sure about how it's going to manifest itself.
So what team has it though?
Winton has it right now. Others have access to it and are just thinking of, everybody's working on goal setting. Some chose to open Protean and then work on goal setting. Others are working on the goal setting and then will open Protean with the goal setting they've done on paper. So it's this common theme with multiple threads of how we're going to get to where we want to go.
And you can go to the next slide now. So that covers how we're going about documenting the student's learning. All right. And just to share with you some of the ways we're personalized learning around different goals that students have. Our Arts and Citizenship program involves several different teachers that come together with our eighth grade students. It's really a capstone for them as they think about, right? And we have one of our community partners, the Shelburne Craft School, and students get to have an opportunity over there to use some materials that we don't necessarily have at our school, right? So they're doing pottery and they're making these great projects. Also a component to it, and all the students meet these three components, right? The community-based service projects, right? So they're doing stuff at the town offices with Shelburne Farms. So they're doing various things throughout the community. And we're finding that these service projects are really good, right? There's a project base to it. It can have, it can be based around the student goals, and it can also meet our proficiencies, right? Those transferable skills. And then there's also independent art projects. And I actually have another tab opened up here. I just want to give you a sense of, so that last year was the first time I entered into, that's the one, the Arts and Citizenship classroom. And I was so amazed because the first day students were, they had a little intro, and then they were given this planning form, right? And what is it you want to learn? And it was so open, and I was amazed by that. And students got some guidance about it, but it was great because students got to say, here's what I want to learn. Here's the skills I want to get, right? About art and about creativity, right? Here's the understandings I want to take away from, right? What do you already know? These are some of the things that students are thinking about. And throughout the time in the Arts and Citizenship program, they're turning back to this, and they're revising it. And they're conferencing with their teachers and conferencing with each other about how to, what is it they want to learn. So it's really great to see that they're getting to weigh in on that. And then another way we're doing it, if you go back to that one. Okay. All right, so we're also seeing personalized moments like crop up in each of the classrooms. And one of the teachers, Sam Nelson, he led about, he just had a discussion with his students. He started there, and then he removed himself from the discussion. It was about climate awareness. And he basically, as students came up with topics, he was just the recorder. He was noting them down. And students were having this great conversation, and every now and then he would interject, but to keep the conversation going. And then these students took their understandings, and they used different media. They used Instagram, they used Twitter, they used blogs to basically make these awareness moments for people to come and see and get their word out, right? So that's clear and effective communication. And when he talks about this, he's like, the only thing I should have done is I should have started the year with this, and then we could have kept it going. And so he's talking about how he might adjust that. But So we're seeing sort of these personalized learning moments sort of pop up in each of our classrooms, and we're trying to find a way how we can get that, become better at that, and connect those to the transferable standards. And then these last two slides I want to leave you with is, so the responsible and involved citizenship standard, this is, we're really finding, you know, as we use technology, everything like that, these are the standards here that we're basing our digital citizenship program on. So as students are using technology, well, we have to figure out how we can use this effectively and positively, right? So we're not posting things that we shouldn't be, right? We've got to demonstrate respect. So these are the skills we're looking at as we approach our digital citizenship curriculum. And these are the themes we're working on, right? Students are learning that they have a digital footprint, that everything they do online has these little moments of being recorded. You're building it up, and you really think about what you're putting out there, right? And their reputation, and privacy and security, and how important that is today. And cyberbullying, and being aware of that, and how digital dramas can just take off online that maybe they wouldn't if you were face-to-face. We talk a lot about the pitfalls and benefits of technology, and we show both. Relationships and communication, and how being online might change what that interaction looks like. Their own image and identity, and overall just internet safety. And we're really addressing online sources of information, right? What does it mean to use work that you found online? So those are the themes we're certainly touching on with all the students in our school. And I just want to leave you with a project some of the students, so that last year the students had to make a connection and create some kind of product that they were actually connecting to some of those themes. And here's just a little one here.
Wow, you sure know a lot of people. Well, not exactly. I let anyone follow me so I can get more followers. Really? I put my Instagram on private so only the people I know can follow me. But don't you want more followers? I don't want people I don't know looking at pictures of my family and I. Oh, well, I put my location in all of my posts so everyone can see where I am whenever they want. Do you really want people you don't know to see exactly where you are? Well, when you put it that way, I should probably stop doing that and put my Instagram on private. That is probably a good idea. You never know who is on the internet. You have to learn how to use it safely. The internet has many benefits, but it can be dangerous. How can the internet be dangerous? Well, your pictures and social security number could be used by online criminals. Okay, thanks for your advice. See you tomorrow. Bye.
So just a mini demonstration of students reflecting using animation and video to put that together.
And the piece with that I would go back to, just as, again, taking it back to PBL, is if you think of, okay, if we go to summative, that would be an example of a summative in response to this transferable standard, right? We wanted students to be able to demonstrate, not just to answer a question true or false on a test, but truly demonstrate, if you think of the amount of thinking it took to put together that dialogue, took some technical skill. We also find kids being pretty engaged with that technology. So here's a product that demonstrates it. I would say that's a demonstration of proficiency of this responsible involved citizenship through digital means. So that's the type of work we're trying to do, and that would be, again, reported through Jump Rope as, we can go back. And it, to me, it has a whole lot more meaning than even that 98% if we talk about grading and those kind of things. That, you got a 98% on that project. Why? Because it was creative, because I liked it, because I thought it was technically fun, because I thought it was better than a poster? No, because of the content that was there. And you're demonstrating proficiency of a specific piece of learning that we targeted and were real intentional about. So,
it gets rid of the conversation you used to have all the time where the kid says, where did I lose 2 points?
Yeah.
No, that's not the point.
So just in terms of wrapping up with you, we've got a lot of things going on to support proficiency-based learning right now. And the things you're going to hear about, things you'll see, we are doing our best to communicate about this. You might notice if you follow our blog, if you get that, these leaves keep popping up on the blog. That's not by accident. you know, really trying to have this become part of our conversation, because we realize that unless parents and students understand this, we're not going to be successful. They're the ones that really need to, you know, be on the page with us, even while we're learning it. You know, we're doing a lot of collaboration between our teams, digitally sharing, going back and forth, because as you heard, you know, we've got one team kind of rolling out Protean this way, another team rolling out Protean this way, another team rolling out Protean this way. That can be dangerous. It can be really good to have multiple teams doing different things, provided you come back together and share and say, okay, did that get you where you wanted to be? And so we've got even digital means of sharing between and collaborating between teams. And then the other big thing that we're rolling out is just strictly the jump rope reporting, which probably is the one, if you as a board member may hear about it, it's like, oh, I don't get this jump rope thing. Okay, this was when we talked at curriculum nights this year, we gave parents a specific, I said, here's our learning target for you guys. This is what we need you to learn this year, because guess what? That report that I'm going to hand you probably won't make a whole lot of sense. And we've got some work to do, and you're probably all down here in this one where, oh, can you tell me the difference between a content learning target and a transferable standard? And yet we want to get to the point where, oh, every parent's feeling comfortable to take a jump rope report, dig into the program with their son or daughter, and have it make sense, saying, oh, this is where you're being successful, and this is what you need to be working on. Okay, we're living right here, right now, as we come into conferences, and we know that. Okay, but we're working really hard on it to move forward, and a couple of you, are, actually three of you, are going to get to give us feedback on how we're doing relatively soon. So, look forward to it.
Is jump rope being used across the board now? Because I know, seems like last year it was maybe
it
only
is,
used.
It is across the board. It is the only platform in our school.
So every subject in the middle school.
Every subject at the middle school should be unified into a report. Spending a lot of time on that on our Tuesday afternoons. And we're going to roll out trial reports in 2 weeks to the teachers to let them look at them before we roll them out to parents.
That's how one came out today from music.
Yeah. A few of them are getting pushed. Yep. Yep. A few of our trendsetters, and I'm ready to go, and I want to inform my parents. Because really, that's what it should be. Christina just wrapped up a unit, and she wants to share kind of where we're at. That really is should be the logical use of this.
I don't know how long you'll look at it.
Exactly. We'll work on that. Let's see. Let me go the other way. Okay. So this is the progress report that we have shared with parents. And said, you know, we haven't shared it specifically, but we said that this is our goal. We want to be able to sit down here in the space of a month and have that report make some sense, and then have parents be able to dig down, because there still is some very specific learning. We don't want to miss that. Because I think it's very dangerous for people to think, oh, it's just all soft, and all I have to show is my self-direction. It's like, no, you still got to be able to write equations. You still have to be able to use a graphing calculator. You can graph equations. You can plot points. Those content are still happening in our classroom today. We've just taken a step beyond that and said, for what end?
How often are these updated in terms with the formative assessments?
You know, there's two levels of it really that we're learning about right now. There is a level that teachers use, and teachers are learning to update this on a regular basis because they're the ones that really need the information. What we're struggling to figure out is what's the right amount of information to give a parent that makes sense, because we could put this in front of somebody and their eyes just go buggy. And so these are going to come out, I would say, roughly on a monthly, bi-monthly basis.
Like progress.
But the access to it being through the parent-student portal, you can get into it in real time as teachers update it. So
how often should a parent look at it?
That's a great question. If I knew that answer, I would tell you.
Maybe you don't know yet.
I don't think we know yet.
My view would be, if I'm starting with those reports on the left there, as soon as I start understanding what this means about my student as a transferable learner, now I'm going to start asking the questions, okay, but what's that look like in math class? What's that look like? And that's where I'm going to want to know. And then when I start to see that information, I start understanding that, I'm going to want to know, okay, you're not proficient in this. Let's look at your assessments, and let's figure out where we need to help you. So it's really dependent upon the parent's comfort and inquisitiveness and engagement, involvement, and it's our job to try and promote that.
Yeah, one thing that Jeff has been a master of
is creating screencasts for us, because we find that that piece of technology is really good. You know, you can spend a lot of time going back and forth with a parent, but how about a 1 minute video that shows, oh, here's how you open up, here's how you navigate. And so we're creating a suite of those. Right now we have a suite of those for teachers in terms of here are, you know, 10 or 15 little videos that show, you got a problem, go here. We're gonna be creating the same kind of thing for parents. You got a question, here's how you can dig in to get this level of information. Those don't really exist yet. But as we, that's one way we'll address it.
Is this a compilation of parent stuff and the work that Jeff is doing, or is it? Are they not really associated?
They're incredibly associated in the sense that Tarrant came on board to support us in improving middle-level education. And everything we're doing here is actually, middle-level nationwide has been kind of leaders in interdisciplinary work. And so it just is a representation of what high-quality middle schools have been doing for a long time. And so, you know, even as I think even this next slide might, yeah, if I go here, you know, here's kind of the work we're doing right now. You know, we've got a couple of consultants that come in on a pretty regular basis. One of them really supported by Tarrant, the other supported by CSSU. So we had Bill Rich, who's been working with us. He really was an expert on differentiated instruction, if you remember that term. And then Stan and Emily come to us. They'll be with us next Monday, Tuesday. Starting next week, we know that the current schedule that we have in our middle school doesn't work for what we're trying to do. You can't break up the day into 45-minute blocks and expect students to make connections between those 45-minute blocks. You really need, even the new building we're putting together is designed to let students have some content and go apply it. That takes time. And so we need 2 to 3 hour chunks of time. We don't have a schedule that supports that, and Tarrant's guiding that work for us. They're researching schools around the country, putting us in touch with thought experts. We've got a committee exploring what our new schedule is going to look like next year. We're already working on it because we know what we've got doesn't work. Tarrant gave us $6,000. We're going to take our leadership team down to Washington, D.C. next month. And we know project-based learning is really the basis of what we want to be doing. That's those summatives that we're talking about. But project-based learning has had some real weaknesses that's been applied to education, because you get these really pretty projects with terrible content. And the challenge is, if you really allow students to personalize, how does a teacher even manage that? How do you keep track of that? So there's an institute out in California, the Buck Institute, which is the nationwide leader on project-based learning. They're running the seminar. That's where we're going. And then Tarrant's working to bring them here this summer to our Middle Grades Institute so we can have follow-up with them. So I'd say, in answer to your question, they're blended. For fear of walking away with, you know, a little bit of egg on our face, or whipped cream in this case of Sam Nelson, these are the things we haven't figured out yet, to be perfectly honest, and we try to be honest with families about that. We're still filling out our e-portfolios and PLPs. Those of you who have a sixth grader realize we've just changed. Last year e-portfolios were the way, now we've got this Protean and e-portfolios. We're figuring that out. I hear about this all the time. Alan, when are we going to slow down? We're pushing really hard here. That we have the danger of just drowning people and even drowning parents too much too quick. So we're trying to balance that. You know, we need to become really proficient at targets ourselves. That's not a skill set that we have, so it takes a lot of time to do it well. And then digital citizenship, we brought all this technology in. Here's what I dealt with today, is it is a bad idea to walk down the hallway flipping your Chromebook in your hands. Okay, well, you know, we've got some basic, we still deal with 11, 12, and 13-year-olds. And so how do we, you know, we can have all these highfalutin goals, we got to remember we're dealing with kids. And the fact that any one of them can do a really poor search and pull up some really disgusting things. And so how do we teach them to deal with that? Because we've opened the window. We put the tool in their hand. We're responsible for that. We recognize it. And then just how does all this come together? Where does Jump Rope and Google Classroom and PLPs and portfolios and everything else we're doing, how does it all fit together? Okay. It's complicated work. It's really good and exciting work. And we'll talk to you about it over the next
set of board meetings, we'll talk about where it fits in math and language arts and science and social studies. That's what's coming, but we thought we'd start with this overview today and have Jeff kind of be here to help us. So hopefully that was helpful. Informative.
Good.
Okay.
Thank
We're
you.
Excited about the work. So thanks for coming and joining us, Jeff.
Thank you.
Any questions for
Thank
us?
You, Jeff.
Thank you. Yeah, very much. So overall feelings on the whole thing? So I'll say from my standpoint in terms of my personal learning experiences. So I did my MBA and it was an online MBA. It was very, and my goal around it was get as close as I could to 4.0 while doing as little work as humanly possible. And I was very successful in both of those spheres. And so my concern with a lot of technology-based learning is it's often easy to lose that really dynamic classroom environment. And the other thing I often think is, kids, when I get reported back to by my kids what they did, it's very often I got a 97 on a test or something like that. So kids really, part of engaged learning, having, it's a little bit like sports, having that level of competition gets you engaged and excited around these things. And so, finding that path between what often feel like very nebulous goals and standards that kids have a difficult time articulating. In fact, all of us have somewhat of a difficult time articulating, and sort of playing to the natural desire for kids to, I think they oftentimes they sink into content. Everyone talks about how boring XYZ class was because they had to memorize, the date that whatever the British invaded Washington. Or of 1812, but striking that balance between content and giving them enough, not overwhelming them, but giving them enough to kind of sink their teeth into where they feel like, oh yeah, this is what I learned today. Mm-hmm. Because again, I think some of the abstract things, which I am very supportive of and very recognizing of the importance of, sometimes it can be lost in the overall goals is just feels like a little bit of an observation. I don't think there's a right answer here. And again, I think, the clueless comment is, we are dramatically changing the world. Again, we recognize what we've been doing for the last 100 years is not always working. And
the piece I would point out that gets me excited is, first of all, none of us are abandoning that dynamic teacher with kids.
Yeah.
That, especially in a primary school, we recognize, we're not ready to just turn learning over to kids and say, what do you want to learn? There are, within communication, within thinking, there are very specific sets of content. And, honestly, if 20% of a student's day looks like this in a couple years, I think we've done incredible work. It's still going to be 80% of teacher-chosen content standards. The question is, where do we let them go with it?
Right. Yep.
The other piece I would put that is, what education has felt like for about the last 15 years, I think, has been, as we've gone to standards, is this trudge through this litany of standards.
Right.
And you start here, and you got to get here.
Yep.
And, I know you're really interested in it, but we got to go on to this standard.
Right.
And we got to get to this one, and we got to get to this one. This is really giving teachers permission to say, hey, go deep in something. We don't have to cover all of that content.
Right.
What are you going to go deep in? Because either you're passionate about it, the kids are passionate about it, and it's going to be a great example of allowing them to show those transferable
right.
skills. The challenge before us, nobody in education has been able to come to some agreement about which content goes away and which content
right.
stays. As a science person, I'll tell you that I've watched the battles between, we'll narrow it down, and I love biology, so let's throw the chemistry away.
Yeah, right, exactly.
And so we don't quite have that sorted out.
Right.
And that's going to be a challenge, because we know we can't do it.
Yep.
The knowledge is increasing exponentially anyways.
Right.
We can't learn it all.
Yeah. Yep. Good stuff.
Sorry for the soapbox.
No? I appreciate it.
It's
I appreciate
exciting
the
stuff.
Discussion. It is. It is. Yep,
yeah.
Absolutely.
All right.
Absolutely.
Thank you for joining us, Jeff.
Thanks, Jeff.
Yeah, very much, Jeff.
All right. You want to unpack you? Oh, can I give you my facilities report really quickly? Just because it's on the computer.
Yeah, sure.
Can I? There's 26 seconds. Here you go. is all you need to know. This is today.
All right.
So we have walls going up in D Wing. Today was the first. And so I can tell you more during the facility report, but I know Jeff's going to take his computer and we have that set up.
Yeah.
Thank you
so much, everyone.
All right. So do we have a principal's report?
We do. Concise one tonight. The only thing I'm going to talk to you about is enrollment. And I just want to give you data because I think it's going to be really relevant as we move forward with CESD and budgets. And so, yeah. So on the front of that report there is just our enrollments
staying really stable. You know, we're at 737. I think our class sizes are optimal right where we want them. I think we did a really nice job last spring. I think that was a really smart decision to add that fifth teacher to the third grade because, you know, we'd be looking at class sizes approaching 25.
Yeah.
That would be a problem. We'd all be sitting in meetings like we were a few years ago. Mm-hmm. So thank you for that. Put the projections underneath. Those were just released by the state. And so you can see that the state's predicting that, yeah, over the next, you know, 6 to 8 years, We're going to grow, yeah, we're going to grow up to about 780 by 2021. That's manageable, but they're not predicting any flat line. They're, in fact, predicting a jump in about 2 years of 20 kids. But, of course, strewn across all grade levels. So you know, that goes without saying that that may be a little complicated. You flip on the back, this is just the data I wanted to show you because I do think it's important that we start doing a little thinking on this one. So in the blue, that's our current enrollment, current class sizes. We currently have, you know, whereas typically we would have 4 teachers per grade level and that works pretty well, we have put 5 at kindergarten, 5 at first, and 5 at third. And I don't think that, I think that was absolutely where we need to be. As we think about next year, well, one decision was when we talked last spring and added at the board retreat, remember we added that third grade teacher, that was a 1-year deal. And so going forward, the question is, okay, as those third graders go into fourth grade, if we don't do something about that, those class sizes in fourth grade over in kind of the beige for fourth grade will be 24 to 25. And it would stay that way because those classes loop. We kind of have to make a decision this year because they would stay together that way. Same with kind of our first graders. You know, our first graders are broken into 5 groups. I will tell you that's one of our more challenging behavior groups right now. That was our kindergartners from last year. And so even though right now our first grade, you know, those class sizes, yeah, they're relatively small. They're 15, 16. Boy, I wouldn't recommend, first of all, I wouldn't want to reconfigure those in the middle of the year because we've kind of made a 2-year deal. And so I would expect that we're going to keep those 5 going forward. So I just wanted to put it out there as food for thought just because I'm, you know, it's going to be a little different budget process this year with, you know, CSSU looking at it, making recommendations to CVSD. But, you know, depending on what you recommend, I'm supposed to sit at a staffing meeting next week. And I guess my questioning is, does this board feel that keeping 5 teachers at that third grade level going into 4 or 5 is an intelligent move that you'd like administration to be advocating for going forward? It's a question.
Are you saying that you want to
move the five teachers?
From third grade to fourth grade?
I would.
Follow the class?
Right now, as they give our baseline budget for next year, we will have four teachers at fourth grade. Because we only said that was a one-year deal. And I'd like to make the push that, boy, we really need those five, that's 97 kids. We don't want to break that into groups of four. We want to keep that in a pairing of five for the next year. No.
But you have a little pinch going from first to second.
Second, too.
Got a little pinch going from first to second. You're right. So, and the projection is our K class is going to be just as big next year. The interesting thing, I did put that there, is I had assumed for years, I think we've had the conversation here as a board, that, oh, we always had five or six first graders. And then I look back at the data, and we always drop three or four K into first. Until I looked at the data, the projections that have come out, and I look and go, oh, from year to year, even in history, as I pulled up other data, I guess I don't have it here, but I went back in history and looked at the data, but consistently we do go backwards. We're not adding first graders. And that's where this projection has come from. All this projection is built on big K classes get a little bit smaller in first rather than growing and needing to add.
Right.
So the question for us will be, okay, do we think, we could get away with four teachers with 80 kids? Well, if it's down in the 76 range, okay, maybe.
I think as you noted, it very much depends on, the student population.
Where those kids come in.
Yeah, exactly.
But I don't think, the population's going to, so say it drops five from the 81, you're still going to have 76 coming into first grade. You've got five teachers for 76 this year.
Yeah.
I don't know why we would think that we would only want four teachers for 76 next year.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Because typically we've tried to target, we put our top end at 20. We've said if we don't have 80 kids, we can do it with four. It's right on that bubble. It's challenging. I mean, I don't know that there's and I don't think we're going to hash it out tonight. This is not meant to be an enrollment. It was meant to be a principal's report and make sure you have the data to kind of inform the conversation. And if you'd like me doing some work over the next month before we come back in November, come in and say, hey, come in with three or four things.
So I think part of the budget process that they've set up is that they're going to go through each school and they're going to look at, students and teachers, and they're going to look at these numbers of class size, and if there are things that are above average size for you, you need to point that out to Elaine and her team when they come in and do that review. And then those numbers will get fed into the CVSD budget.
Yep.
So. Yeah. But that review is coming up.
It's relatively soon.
Yeah. So, that's where you provide your input to Elaine and her team.
Yep.
And then they'll put those recommendations to the CVSD board.
Mm-hmm.
And then our chair will advocate strongly for.
We will.
Don't forget your research, Dave.
We'll equitably allocate resources where the data indicates.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Are there any other configurations that you could possibly see that would satisfy the needs? I mean, at a glance, can't see anything else other than having those five teachers.
Yeah, that 98 there, that big class, we could absorb. When it gets to middle school, we'll be able to absorb it. We've absorbed 105 in middle school and 25, 26, but it's just a different animal.
Yeah.
When they go to separate classes.
Yeah.
So.
So that means that for two more years, we would need those five teachers, unless
there
was some drastic change where students left
in
a large number.
Yep.
And so do you know if the teacher who is on contract now is able to or willing to continue for a year or two?
Probably not good for me to publicly.
Okay. Yep, understood. But I think that would be in the mix as well.
Yeah, certainly. The two folks that we've hired are fantastic. We're excited to have them.
Okay.
I would say, if it comes time to let them go in the spring, that'll be disappointing, because they're doing good work.
Mm-hmm, okay.
Yep, we've got good quality people in all our positions right now, fortunately. So, that's my report for you.
Good,
thank you.
Lots of other good stuff happening, but.
How's Patty doing, by the way?
We're waiting to hear the results of her exam today. Recovering slowly, but slow is the term of the day, I think.
Yep.
Yeah. Damage was substantial.
Yes, that's what I understand.
So, move on to the CVS debrief. We met 2 weeks ago, formed our three committees. We have finance, negotiations, and communications. The finance and negotiations committee will have their first meetings next week. And, you know, we came up with charters for those. Once those are finalized, we'll send them out to everyone. We started the first draft of the budget process, very similar to what you saw tonight at the CSSU meeting. And we're just moving forward.
What committees are our Shelburne representatives on?
So there's a Shelburne representative on each committee. Russ is on the negotiations committee, and Joan is on the finance committee, and I am on the communications committee. So, yeah. We tried to strive for one member or a member of each town on each committee, and no more than one member from each town. So you can't have a committee with four members that has two members from one town, ideally. So, and the exception is St. George doesn't need to be on every committee. So.
So like Charlotte, who has two, will they only be on two committees then?
They're currently only on two committees, one each. But they can be on other committees. What I was trying to say is multiple members of the same town on the same committee. So, CSSU debrief, just had a great setup for performance-based learning. It's a pretty dry agenda. Anything pop out at you guys? Nothing big. Starting to shorten that meeting a little bit. And so we'll go on to facilities committee. If you could tell Bob to head on down. So which one of you guys is going to talk about the facility? Just give us a quick update aside from we have a new wall.
Yep, we got a new wall. We have a schedule. We have
firmed up the schedule that the move into D-Wing will be over February break. So it had been back and forth whether we were going to do it at the holiday break in December or February. Just worked out better. Doesn't cost, no increase in cost, no increase in pension. There's some real benefits to it. So the schedule's been built around that, and everybody's real confident because there's even a little bit of a buffer there. It was going to be pretty tight to make it by December. Things are coming in under budget, on schedule. Moving right along.
Is the community going to be invited in when all of the work is done to see what it looks like and have a tour?
It would. I think that would be a great idea. Mm-hmm. I think
we're probably going to have some time.
Yep.
In between Christmas and move February,
when it's kind of ready,
kind of completed and not occupied yet.
I think that would be a great
board sponsored. Yeah, and I think people are going to be really excited to see it.
It's awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yep. It'll be the cleanest it will ever be.
Exactly.
Yep.
You know, I think the only other thing, and I don't know if this is the appropriate time, but, you know, as Alan alluded to, you know, the budget numbers are favorable at this point, so there are some things that we probably will be able to do that weren't in the initial budget. You know, we're going to come back and talk to you about the fire alarm that we spoke about last meeting when the numbers get firmed up on that. But there are other things, so if there's input from any other board members of things that you think we really missed and
didn't include or you'd like to see, I think that would be.
Things that were kind of cut from 11 going to 9.
Kitchen?
So, yeah, like kitchen, those kind of things, but get those to Alan or Chris or myself, because we're going to meet next Tuesday, Thursday, to discuss where we are and what should be the focus.
So please register, I think the idea of the kitchen would be great.
Yep. Very much so. In kind of a parallel strand, as we are in the midst.
Chris Yard and I are preparing a 5-year capital plan that we'll bring to you. It really goes to CVSD, but you know we'll bring it and kind of share, because some things, you know, if the kitchen can be done under the capital plan, you know, here's a scope of work we want to get done.
Yeah, great.
So. We almost made it.
Yeah.
We approved the alternate fire plan. So we approved if we were going to go out and see proposals on the alternate fire plan.
Yeah. We'll come back with specific bids and approval of a dollar amount. That piece we haven't brought to you.
Okay.
Okay. Good.
Okay.
That's great.
Yeah.
Perfect. All right.
So move on to 6-1 board sworners. Matt's going to say that the solar company needs homework. You can't get the data out of them still. Is that right? Sadly, unfortunately. I haven't done too much arm twisting, but I will.
Okay.
If you want arm twisting, that will be a nice force.
Brother, were all your friends coming up to do that?
Yeah. Exactly. Yes, they were.
Was that going to be the next board's corner?
One of them, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Was there another one where you signed for you?
It came out.
It did.
You didn't read it?
Thank you.
I'm sorry.
No worries.
It was a good one.
It was awesome.
Thank you. Yes, Alan provided me with excellent, excellent information. I just added words here and there to flesh it out, and it was clear and concise, and it didn't make an impression on you.
Well, when was it in the paper?
Last week.
Okay, I'll go back and look.
Please.
Yeah. Buzz in the community, except
me. Yeah.
Busy with hockey.
Did you hit your head on that bike ride?
I don't read the Shelburne News all the time, you know, I guess.
You're more of a front page forum guy, so we should put it in there.
And Vermont Digger.
That's right. But we should run it past each other.
Yes, so sorry. That is absolutely true. It came down to the very last minute getting it out and my oversight on that part. Sorry.
Okay.
And I'm just curious, Alan.
It would be reasonable to assume that, like, the principal's report was something different just because you're super busy with understaffed?
That is a good assumption.
Okay. All right.
Plus, I did want you to see the enrollment.
We got that all in an email from Sandy earlier in the week, so
okay.
Just so you know.
Yep.
So Bob is here to talk action matters. 7.1, could I get a motion to approve the boundary adjustment request on Long Meadow property?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Second by Tim. And discussion? It's in a nice map in our thing here.
I'm not sure how much of it is clear, because none of you were around in 1967 when your predecessors purchased the property as a site for the new Shelburne Elementary School.
Yeah.
Subsequently found property far more suitable for the new Shelburne Elementary School on Harbor Road. And so the property, said property, has been unused since the date it was purchased. They purchased the property from Mr. Farrell all the way back in 1967. Subsequently, that board had to go back in and buy out an easement restriction that was in the deed. You see the long right-of-way back to the property? The original deed had an obligation that the school district was going to develop that right-of-way for the use of both themselves and others, and the prior owner owned both properties on both sides. And the school district in the early 70s realized they weren't going to develop the property. They didn't want to be obligated to
provide that right away to adjacent owners, so they purchased buying that clause out of the deed. So there was two transactions the board back in 67 and 70 made for the property. It has sat unused. It periodically, it has a folder in my office. The folder comes out periodically when somebody in the town believes they've got an excellent use for that. We explore it, we look at it, and it goes back into the file. The last time it came out was when your predecessors more recently wanted to investigate the possible sale of the property. Mm-hmm. So you paid for a property assessment to be done by a local commercial real estate person. And it also came out when the school in town thought about both using it as playing fields and using it as a solar farm. Mm-hmm. Neither of those played out to any degree of action. So that's the property. Lynn Roberts is granddaughter of the gentleman who owned all the property. She and her husband own both the property to the south and the property to the north. The property to the south is where the Shelburne storage units are. The property to the north is where a significant amount of fill was deposited when we did the Route 7 upgrades. So the level of that, this north property, is about 10 feet higher than everything else surrounding. So that gives you an idea where the location is. What the Roberts are asking is, would you mind if they take the right away, and as it comes back across the bridge that's already there, turn it up onto the higher elevation of the filled-in property, go all the way back to your owned property, and then turn back down onto it. So that they can then site the new building units that they would like to put in on their property, which they can't do right now because the new ones would be located too close to the boundary with the current easement, which you own. So that's their request. Would you mind moving the owned right-of-way after it crosses the bridge up onto the property back and then back down to the property you own way back in the Longmeadow Woods? So that's my quick executive summary. What have I left out that needs clarification?
I can't envision how they want that to change. Can you draw that in on that piece of paper so we can see what that means?
The new right-of-way would do this. Something like that. So it would go across the brook. Mm-hmm. And then would just before you take the driveway over to the storage units, it would turn to the north, go up the hill, go down along parallel to the existing right-of-way, but 30 feet to the north of where it is now, and then come back down into the original right-of-way after the end of the property.
So it gives them more space in the lot to the south, correct?
Yeah, this proposed new units... Yeah. Are way too close to the boundary for current town regulations.
Right.
So they're looking to be able to site, particularly these two, by taking this owned right away and moving it up here.
Mm-hmm. Do you have an end game for this property that we can think of?
Not that I've heard from you.
Well, so whatever happened when it was on, you said somebody pursued selling it. Why didn't that go anywhere?
Russ was the chair.
Let's flip Bob answer the
question. Okay, sorry.
Russ was the chair,
yeah.
And the assessment by the assessor was a relatively low amount of real property value, and the market for anyone buying it was relatively insignificant, and probably it would be on the market for quite some time to find anybody interested in it.
But do we know if the change to form-based zoning
has significantly altered the value of that property?
I do not think so. The property was originally sold to the school in the time when the best locations for schools were property that was generally wet and not valuable for much of anything else, aka your Harbor Road School and this site. The wetland extensions have grown significantly since 1967, so it would be a long way back to a relatively small piece of usable property. you should form your own opinion, but I mean, that's kind of how the group read it back.
Does this easement, it sounds like if they're doing development back across the area, it may enhance the value of the property by improving its accessibility. Is that a fair assumption?
Yeah, I can't get there. The new roadway that you will now have to relatively unusable property in the back is going to go in, across a bridge, up a hill, elevated, come back down to your right-of-way, and then go back. I can't see it, the word enhancement.
Just putting a turn in the road.
Two turns in the road and moving it north.
We don't
it's an accommodation.
Is there a DRB file for this development that they need this easement for?
Say that one again.
Oh, there should be.
Is there a DRB file open for them to add these units to their?
I suspect there is, but it might have been just a conversation their attorney and the town have had relative to the likelihood of permitting. They do know that they can't put at least this last two added unit in that's really close to the right-of-way. You can see it almost overlaps the right-of-way. They can't put that one in without some sort of relief.
Because there was a third page that you gave us in the initial piece, I thought, that had a very long straight line going through this property, and it said future extension. And I just want to make sure that we're not granting an easement for a development that hasn't been vetted, only to find out that somebody's putting a gas pipeline through this, and we're the ones who gave them the easement.
No, the back of the property fronts the proposed, one of the proposed routes for the Shelburne interconnected bike path that would run from the Martindale development down to the Longmeadow development. And then, so that's where that bike path course is. And in fact, one of these maps, you'll see there's a purported right of way out from that path to Route 7, just north of their property.
Okay, that must have been what I saw there. It didn't say bike path, but I was curious.
Yeah.
So, I don't know how you guys feel, but
I mean, my opinion is, you know, I didn't get Bob's package, so I haven't really looked at it closely. But I think before the board goes and gives away a right-of-way or changes a right-of-way, that it's incumbent upon us to do a little bit more due diligence, whether that's meeting with the chair of the DRB or whatever, and just try to really understand what the long-term implications of doing that are, instead of just being nice guy neighbor and giving it away and find out that something else, you know, not that I'm opposed to doing it, but I don't think I have enough facts to make a educated decision one way or the other.
And would it be consulting with our lawyer also?
I have already begun that process because any sort of recommendation I give you would have to be based on an understanding of legal process. Mm-hmm. It is extremely difficult for you to quickly and straightforward sell property without a whole lot of legal process, including a vote by your electorate. It is, in the opinion of your attorney, not necessarily that you go through those hoops if you're making a boundary line adjustment. And shifting the right-of-way would, in his mind, be a boundary line adjustment. Mm-hmm. So that's the extent of the legal work. I would recommend whoever on the board kind of picks this one up, do a site visit, because these sketches don't make as much sense to someone as standing at the base of that right of way and looking at where it goes would serve you.
But are you saying that, according to counsel, it would also be problematic if we said, hey, we have no problem with this, to make the transaction happen as well?
No, in essence, he would say it's okay.
Oh, okay.
It is within your power to do a boundary line adjustment. It is not within your power to...
We can't sell it, but
we can't
give
sell
it away.
Yeah, but well, you can shift the boundary line.
So the motion on the table is to approve this easement. So I think I've heard from some that we recommend that we do not approve this. And we would touch base with the DRB in order to get some more information about this and see if there is a case on file. So all those in favor of the motion, say aye. All those not in favor, say nay.
Nay.
Nay, okay, so the motion fails. And we'll circle back with the DRB. And by we, I would say Bob and I will confer and figure out who to contact and what needed steps would be. Thanks for this, though. I appreciate it. All right.
Matt, so you and I don't trip over on the solar. Where I understand the solar is, they're very good at sending us invoices for the payment to the investment consortium. They've not necessarily mastered the process to take credits through GMP so that you and I get a check. So Hilda paid the first payment to the investment consortium. We're not paying any more until they get their problems worked out with GMP.
You have my full support there.
So that's where we are.
Be in your front page for.
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely.
So number two was roofing.
Oh, that's in your packet.
Yeah.
We have a roofing contractor.
Yeah.
We're all happy with the choice. We're all happy with the price. Yep. We'd like your endorsement, and we'll get running.
Yeah, you found three folks to bid. You picked one. It's not the person who's doing the current section of the roof, or it is?
It is not. It's a bit of a disappointment. The one you had doing the roof is probably one of the best in Vermont. The one you have doing the next roof is one of the best in northern New York, of the same caliber as the vendor here. So we're switching. It's the right thing to do. From a business perspective, it's a difficult thing to do with somebody who did good work on the front half. Is that a fair expression of the sentiments around the table?
But again, through the bid process,
they had the low bid.
We don't have a lot of choice.
Yeah, right. Right.
No, yeah, we don't have to go to the AOE for a waiver on this one.
Does this contractor store fire extinguishers on the roof during during construction?
I'll clarify the obligations he has.
Okay, just curious.
He or just she curious. Have when they come on
so,
site.
Could I get a motion to approve the roofing award for phase two?
Second
by Tim. I don't have the name of the contractor right in front of me.
Monahan and Laughlin.
Monahan and Laughlin is contractor. Any discussion? Any further discussion? All those in favor of awarding this to Monahan and Laughlin, say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries.
Just one further comment based on today's construction meeting. Shelburne is now a very difficult school to find a ladder that you can use to get up to the second, the roof. Yeah. We've effectively eliminated access to all of those.
We'll continue this conversation when we're not on camera, so these people know what I'm talking about. So.
Am I done?
Yes, thank
okay,
you.
Thank you, Bob.
Thank you, Bob.
Can I get a motion to approve the consent agenda?
So moved.
Second by Matt. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Carries. Our next meeting date is November 15th. And CSSU right before it. And we will go into executive session. We don't need Jeff or Alan.
Nope.
Nope.
I do need to give you something to sign.
And we will adjourn from executive session.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you.